We're down in chapter 43. We got down to verse 12, and actually I went kind of skimmed down through verse 12 to 27 with you last time. I want to go back to verse number 12, because in order to understand what's going to be talked about in the latter part of this chapter and the next chapter, especially in regard to the sacrifices, and of course this part of the book of Ezekiel, the big thing in the mind of people is why are these sacrifices that are being made, the burnt offerings and the sin offering and the six specific ones that he gives them. He dedicates the temple in verse 19 through verse 27 with a couple of offerings, the sin offering and the burnt offering. And then they give six specific ones that they keep on a daily basis. And so there's a question about all of that. But it really, to understand that, as I read these things, you need to get verse number 12. So I want to spend a little time just going back over chapter 43, verse number 12. He describes, as you come through the chapters, 42, 40, 41, 42, he describes the temple, the dimensions of the temple, the activities and so forth, what it looks like. And then in chapter 43, he starts talking about verse number 2, "Behold, the glory of the Lord, the God of Israel, came from the way of the east." And you have the second advent of Christ, when the Son of Man shall come in his glory with all his holy angels with him, and he comes and he fills up the temple. And he comes there to dwell. Verse number 7, "He said unto me, Son of man, the place of my throne and the place of the soles of my feet where I will dwell in the midst of the children of Israel forever." That's what the temple is going to be. "And my holy name shall the house of Israel no more defile, neither shall they nor their kings, nor by their whoredoms, nor by the carcasses of their kings in their high places." So he's going to come and set up his throne. The temple is the place where he's going to dwell. His presence is going to be, the manifestation of his glory is going to be there, but it's also the place of his throne. He isn't just the fact that there's the temple in the sense of the presence. His presence is there, but this is a place where he's going to do business from. This is the place in which he's going to rule the universe, and he calls it my house. In other words, I'm going to dwell there. My throne's going to be there. This is the place in which he's going to run the whole cosmos. And that's important to understand that, because sometimes we think about the temple, it's just, you know, like a church building. It's not that at all. This is the place where Jehovah is going to set up his headquarters from which he rules the whole universe. Verse number, when he talks to them there in verse 7, and he talks about the place, "My holy name, no more defile it." Then he talks about how they defile it in verse 8, 9, 10, and 11. And they defile it by the Baal worship, by worshiping other gods. That is an issue of polluting, contaminating, violating the holiness, the separateness, the fact that this is where Jehovah's going to live. This is sacred. This is set apart for him. And nothing is going to defile it. He won't let it. So verse 12, when he concludes that, "This is the law of the house." So this is the law. This is the way it's going to operate. "Upon the top of the mountain, the whole limit thereof, round about, shall be most holy. Behold, this is the law of the house." So the law of the house, the way that temple is going to be, is that it's holy ground. You remember in Exodus when Moses is standing at the burning bush, it says, "Take your shoes off of the ground." You stand on his holy ground. God's presence is there. That's what sanctifies that place. And so this place is going to be the most holy, the place where he does. You know, you remember in the tabernacle, they had the holy, and then they have what preachers call the holy of holies. You know, the Bible never calls it that. That's an interesting thing. It always calls it the most holy, because that's where God's presence was. This is the place where nothing that defiles can come in. Well, there's nothing that's going to defile and pollute and contaminate can enter into this place, because this is where the Lord is going to live. And the contamination, of course, we've seen this all through Ezekiel, that caused him to leave the land, his land, the place of his dwelling in his land. You know, Jesus says, "Don't swear by Jerusalem, for it's the city of the great king." This is his place. And yet he had to leave it because of the pollution that was, Israel went after other gods. And that's the key defilement. So the issue here about the the law of the temple is that it's going to be holy ground. Now, there's a interesting thing there in verse 12, and it really, I've talked to you about this from time to time. Upon the top of the mountain, the whole limit thereof, round about, that top of the mountain is here. Come over with me to the book of Micah, to the right, right after the book of Jonah. Book of Micah, chapter number 4. Micah chapter, that is the top of the mountain. That's a phrase in the Bible, especially in prophecy, that has a special meaning in relationship to Jerusalem. And it has a special meaning in relationship to God's government in the earth. A mountain is often used in Scripture to describe a nation, a government, and it's used to describe the kingdom that Christ sets up. Micah chapter 4, and this passage will compare to Isaiah chapter 2. But in the last days it shall come to pass that in the mountain of the house of the Lord, now that's where we are in Ezekiel, shall be established, that the mountain of the house of the Lord shall be established in the top of the mountains. Now that's the other nations of the earth. And it shall be exalted above the hills, and people shall flow unto it. And many nations shall come and say, come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob. And he will teach us of his ways, and we will walk in his paths. For the law shall go forth of Zion, and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. So the mountain of the Lord and the house of God, they're the same thing, parallel expressions, just like when he says that the law is going to go forth from Zion and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. And he shall rule, verse 3, among many people and rebuke strong nations afar off. And they shall beat their swords into plowshares and they shall their spears into pruning hooks. Nation shall not rise up against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. There's going to be a whole new kind of a governmental system, a whole new setup of the way the nations run. The Gentiles are now going to be taught by the nation Israel. And life in the millennium, if you want to see what the kingdom is going to be like, what life in the kingdom is going to be like, you're reading it. Verse 4, they shall sit every man under his vine and under his fig tree. I read that and my mind says, what kind of an economy is that? We call that capitalism. You got your own vine tree, you're not living on somebody else's place, you're living on your own. None shall make them afraid, for the mouth of the Lord of hosts has spoken it. For all people will walk, every one in the name of his God, and will walk in the name of the Lord, our God, forever and ever. So life in the millennium is going to be a wonderful kind of thing. The Lord himself is going to build the temple, by the way. I've said this to you. If you look over at Zechariah chapter, just to the right, Zechariah chapter 6, when you're reading that temple in Ezekiel, it's a spectacular looking thing, beautiful kind of thing. But you say, where'd it come from? God gave Moses instructions how to build the tabernacle. He gave Solomon instructions how to build the temple in Jerusalem. But he doesn't give Ezekiel instructions. It's just there. And where'd it come from? Zechariah chapter 6, verse number 12. I speak unto him, saying, thus speaketh the Lord of hosts, saying, behold the man whose name is the branch. He shall grow up out of his place, and he shall build the temple of the Lord. Even he shall build the temple of the Lord, and he shall bear the glory, and shall sit and rule upon his throne. And he shall be a priest upon his throne, and the council of peace shall be between them both. So that's the Messiah. And he's going to be a priest sitting on the throne. He's going to be the king, but he's going to be a priest after the order of Melchizedek. He's going to be the Redeemer. And he's going to build the temple and bear the glory. So the one that builds this temple back here in Ezekiel is really the Lord. It's not a man building it. It's the dimensions and all the things about that are there are done by him for specific reasons. And It's going to be upon the top of the mountain. That is the high place where the government is established. And his government's going to be there. Micah says he's going to rule the nations. The Gentiles are going to freely come and visit the temple and worship there. We've seen that time and again here. It's going to be a real happy time. They're going to be happy to come. And Israel's going to teach the Gentiles the gospel of the kingdom, the good news, the law principles. So Israel is going to receive her adoption. Paul calls it in Romans chapter 9. They're going to be, you know, he brought them out of Egypt. He says, behold, I brought my firstborn son out of Egypt. Well, Israel grows through childhood and through the new covenant becomes that adopted son, goes into adulthood. Adoption in the Bible is being placed in the position of an adult. And Israel grows into that adoption. They grow into their adult status. They reach that through the new covenant, where he writes his law in their hearts and so on and so forth. And then they began to go out and teach the Gentiles. When the kingdom comes, the new covenant is redeemed Israel, resurrected Old Testament saints. You've got nothing but believers in Israel. You got resurrected people, David's there and so forth. You have all these people, and they're all adults in the family. They all know what's going on. And then you have all the Gentile nations. And that's when the commission in Matthew 28, all power is given unto me in heaven and earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, and teaching them whatsoever things I've taught you. And lo, I'm with you, even to the end of the earth. That's the commission that the believing remnant of Israel will carry out in the millennial kingdom right here. So they're going to carry that thing out and take salvation and blessing to the nations, and they're going to teach them the law. And when they teach them the law is going to tell them, this is the law of the house. This is the most holy place. This is where the Messiah, this is where the King of the universe lives. And there's going to be an altar and a temple. Verse number 13, these are the measures of the altar after the cubit. And then he describes all that. In verse 19, he begins to dedicate the altar. And then they talk about the activities of worship and so forth that they're going to use to teach the Gentiles. Now, once Israel is an adult, they don't need to be taught by childish things anymore, but they're going to go out and teach the Gentiles. They'll use the childish things of the sacrificial system. We'll talk about that in a minute. So when you go through this, and by the way, if you go down through this, we've looked at the temple. If you look at it, there's an obvious difference between the temple here and what Moses had or what Solomon did. In this temple, there's no Ark of the Covenant. There's no veil. All the different things that are the showbread, the golden candlestick, all the things. You go back to Hebrews 9, get the list of things. None of those things are here. This is a different kind of a system. It's a new system, but it's still the law. It's Israel's program, and the way they're going to use to teach the Gentiles the things that God has for them. The Gentiles can be children and be taught by adults. They have six specific sacrifices that we'll have to study about, and they're designed to teach doctrine to the Gentiles, just like they did to Israel in time past. And that's where the real issue comes in, because what is it that they're trying to teach the Gentiles? What are these sacrifices about? Now, the standard teaching is that they are memorials. And if I guess there's two standard, one standard teaching is that this isn't literal. This is all figurative and symbolic and isn't real, that there won't be a real temple, just like there won't be a real millennium. But I think you know better than that. And when you read all the details of this stuff, why would you need all these details, some of which are just really, you know, chapter 41 and 42, I read through that stuff with you, but some of that stuff it's boring building instructions. And you read it and you say, what in the world is this? If this isn't literal, what in the world is this in here for? You know, it just kind of makes sense that but it's not, it's real and literal, but it isn't. Don't miss the illustrations and the doctrine that's in the things. these things are not just there to be looked at. They're there to teach, and they're designed to teach teach doctrine. Now, come with me to Hebrews chapter 10 just for a second. Hebrews chapter 10. I've said to you, and I've talked to you already about the fact that I don't really think these things are, I don't think it's fair to call them memorials, the sacrifices. Because the teaching that these things are going to be memorials like the Lord's Supper and that kind of thing, in 1 Corinthians 11, Paul talks about the Lord's Supper. He said, you know, the Lord had the bread and the cup, and do this in remembrance of me until I come. Well, when he comes, you don't. If this is a memorial, and he comes, you don't need the memorial anymore because he's there. If these things are shadows, if the substance is there, you don't need the shadow. If the substance is there, you say, well, the Gentiles would need the shadow. But if the substance there, just point to him. You don't need to point to the shadow. If you've got a completed Bible, which they have, take the completed Bible and teach them the truth of the gospel. We don't need to do that today. We don't need the shadows today to teach Gentiles. So the memorial, I think the memorial aspect of it, it comes from people who actually misunderstand what the Old Testament sacrifices were really about. And I'm going to make some people mad at me when I say this, but I think that most of what people do when they go back in the book of Leviticus, and I'm going to do this with you, not tonight, but sometime soon. Go back through some of those things back there, and what you'll see is they're not the intricate design picture of what Christ did for you at Calvary. It's fascinating. They're doing something, and they're important, but they're really not what I've got books in my library written by probably six or eight different really good Bible teachers from 100 years ago. And they go through all the symbolism, and the burnt offering is because of fully, totally, complete, dedicated sacrifice of the Lord. But you know what you do with the blood of the burnt offering? You don't put it on anybody. Nobody. They put it on the altar. It's not to sanctify the sinner or the offerer. It's to sanctify the altar. And you say, well, wait a minute. I thought I needed blood. It's the blood applied to me. None of the sacrifices in Leviticus apply the blood to you, to the offerer. They all use it to sanctify the implements and the parts and the things in the tabernacle, to keep them holy. This place is holy. This is the most holy. Nothing can contaminate this tabernacle. That's what the sacrifices are for in Leviticus, was to keep any contamination out of the sacrifice, and for the believer that offers those sacrifices to come and to seek to commune with the God who lives there. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 4. Now, here's a verse that kind of turned my thinking around on some of this. Hebrews 10, 4, 4, it is not possible that the blood of bulls and goats should take away sins. So was it possible for the blood of bulls and goats under the old system to take away sins? No. How do you know? That's what the verse says. So when they offered a burnt offering, sin offering, whatever, peace offering, they were not taking away sins. How do I know? I can read that verse. So all the teaching that goes through all those sacrifices saying these are designed to show you how God takes away sin, he wasn't taking away sin with those sacrifices, so how could they show you that he was? I mean, that's what kind of threw me for a loop. Because the sacrifices were not designed to show you how God would take away sin. If you look down at verse number 20, verse number 18, and you talk about the new covenant, verse 15. And by the way, verse number 8. Above, when he says, sacrifice and offering, burnt offerings and offerings for sin, thou wouldest not, neither hast pleasure therein, which are offered by the law. Then said he, lo, I come to do thy will, O God. that's Christ, taketh away the first, that is the Mosaic sacrificial system, that he may establish the second. He took away the first covenant to establish the second covenant. If he took away the shadow to establish the substance, why do you want to go back to the shadow? He took it away. By the which will, verse 10, we are sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. And every priest standeth daily ministering oft times in the same sacrifice, which can never take away sins. But this man, after he had offered one sacrifice for sins, forever sat down on the right hand of God, from henceforth expect until his enemy made his footstool. For by one offering he had perfected forever them that are sanctified. If you've got a sacrifice that takes care of it once and for all, that's better than the other guy who had some stuff that didn't take care of it at all. And that's what Hebrews is saying. So what you've got in Christ is better than what they had. It's not that what they had pointed you to that. Is they had something that was doing something in Israel's program, but what you've got is something better. Theirs didn't take away sins. Christ does. They kept repeating what they did. Why do you repeat something? Verse 15. Whereof the Holy Ghost also is a witness to us. For after that he hath said before, this is the covenant that I will make with them after those days, saith the Lord. I will put my law in their hearts, and in their minds will I write it. And that's why the law of the house will be accomplished. And their sins and iniquities will I remember no more. Now, where remission of these is, there is no more offering for sin. Now, that just tells you that the sacrifices under the old covenant and the sacrifices in Leviticus in Exodus don't take away sin. Why? Because they repeat them. If it did the job, you don't need to repeat them. So when you're repeating them, they aren't taking away sin. So why would you have a memorial of something that worked by doing things that don't work? So what I'm saying to you is I think the idea about it being a memorial is off the mark because of a lack of understanding what the sacrifices really were about under the old covenant. And that's like I said, I can make people mad at me. You guys sit here and we're friends, and I made somebody mad last Sunday. I said Sunday morning that the word sovereignty is not in the Bible, not in the King James Bible. It is in a lot of modern Bibles, but it's not in the King James Bible. And I knew when I said that I'd make Calvinists mad. And I said it so that I'd kind of poke them a little bit. That's good to get, you get their attention that way, because that's one of their buzzwords, you know, sovereignty. And so I get people saying, well, you know, a lot of other word rapture's not in the Bible either, that kind of stuff. Like, you shouldn't use any word that isn't in the Bible. And, well, okay, you know, if you want to be a purist like that. My problem with that is that I've met a lot of folks that say you should never use any term to categorize doctrine. You know, have a caption that identifies doctrine. I've met a lot of people like that, but they're never consistent. You know, it's always easy to tell the other guy what to do. What you need to do is you do it, and then be an example to the other guy. Maybe he'll learn from you. So anyway, so I'm. It's okay to make folks a little mad, to jar their wagon a little bit. But anyway, before we get into that, I want to do something about this thing about the high mountain, and we'll talk about some of those other things next time or the time after that. You see where he says in verse 8 about upon the top of the high mountain, top of the mountain rather, the whole limit thereof round about, all around that place where God's throne is sacred ground, holy ground. Nobody better can get up there to contaminate it. That's why verse 7, 8, 9, and 10 and 11 tells them, you guys did it. You contaminated it. And what happened to you? You were out. So it's a serious issue when you do that. Now, that throne, throne that he's going to put there is in the top of the mountains. Now, if you go back, we talked about this back in chapter 40 when we started this. Chapter 40, verse number 2. In the visions of God brought he me into the land of Israel, and set me upon a very high mountain, by which was a frame of a city on the south. Now, we looked at that and compared that with Revelation chapter 21. And we saw in Revelation chapter 21. Now, Revelation 21 is after the millennium. It's after the thousand-year kingdom that we're reading about in Ezekiel. And it's an extension of that. And the way you know it's different is because in Revelation 21, that city of Jerusalem has no temple in it. So this is the transition into the eternal kingdom. But when you come to Revelation 21, I saw a new heaven and a new earth. The first heaven and earth had passed away, and there was no more sea. Now notice, the first heaven and earth passed away, and there's no more sea. Now, I'll just put that in the back of your head, because we're going to talk about a verse about that in a minute. Verse number 10, he carried me away in the spirit to a great and high mountain, and showed me that great city, the holy Jerusalem, descending out of heaven from God. So here he's going to take him again. That high mountain is an issue. The place where God's going to rule and the decisions he makes come from to run, operate the universe. Here, he showed me that great city descending out of heaven. In chapter 40 of Ezekiel, the very same high mountain, but he sees the frame of the city. Now, there's one thing about seeing the city, another thing about seeing the frame of the city. And when we're looking at that, when we talk about it, I've tried to make the point to you that this is not Revelation 21. This is now where you're going to see the frame. He's beginning to see this thing come into existence. Now, it's interesting about, it's the city of Jerusalem. Come back with me to chapter 5, Ezekiel chapter 5. And get Ezekiel 5 in one hand and chapter 36 and chapter 48. Ezekiel 5, Ezekiel 36. In Ezekiel chapter 5, I just want you to look at one verse, verse number 5. Thus saith the Lord God, this is Jerusalem. I have set it, Jerusalem, in the midst of the nations and countries that are round about her. Notice that expression, I've set Jerusalem in the midst of the nations. Chapter 36. I'll make it chapter 38, I'm sorry. Chapter 38, where Jerusalem is being invaded by Gog, the armies of Gog and Magog. Ezekiel 38, verse 11. Thou shalt say, I will go up. That's what Gog's going to say as he attacks Jerusalem. To the land of unwalled villages. I will go up to them that are at rest, that dwell safely, all of them dwelling without walls and have neither bars nor gates. Now this is at the end of the thousand years that we're reading about. You see in Revelation 20. To take a spoil and to take a prey, to turn thy hand upon the desolate places that are now inhabited, and upon the people that are gathered out of the nations. So you've got the nations gathered, Israel's gathered, that dwell in the midst of the land. So when they're dwelling in Israel, they're dwelling in the midst of the land. Jerusalem is in the midst of the land. Now come back with me to Numbers chapter 35. Because that expression, the midst of the land, is a expression that if you were an Israeli, you would have some awareness of. Numbers chapter 35. You notice I got on glasses tonight? Now, I had to play the piano a while ago, and I couldn't see the piano. I'm looking like that because I'm trying to read through my bifocals. And I got to tell you, they aren't helping much. Last week I was having trouble reading. I thought I'd wear some glasses tonight. They aren't helping a lot. So I'm not used to hunting. When I'm doing this, I'm hunting a place where my bifocals can read the text. So it just is what it is. I'm waiting to get my new body and get new eyes so I can see. Not because I think you're so wonderful to look at, but so I can read. Numbers chapter 35. Talking about the cities of refuge in verse number 5. Ye shall measure from without the city on the east side 2,000 cubits, and on the south side 2,000 cubits, and on the west side 2,000 cubits, and on the north side 2,000 cubits. Now, if I'm in a city and I've made either 2,000 this way, 2,000 this way, 2,000 this way, 2,000 that way, where am I at? I'm in the middle of it. I'm in the center. The city shall be in the midst. This should be to them the suburbs of the cities. So for the city to be in the midst, what's it talking about? It's mathematically in the center. So when it says Jerusalem is the city in the midst of the nations, the mathematical center, the geographic center of God's view of the world, of the earth, is Jerusalem. It's the city of the great king. It's the center point of planet earth, because that's where God's throne's going to be. So when he talks about Jerusalem being the midst, he's talking about the center of the earth, the command center, if you will. Now look at chapter 40 of Ezekiel about this temple. Chapter 40, verse number 10. And from them, even for the priest, shall this holy oblation toward the north, 5 and 20,000 in length, and toward the south, the west, 10,000 in breadth, and toward the east, 10,000 in breadth, and toward the south, 5 and 20,000 in length, and the sanctuary of the Lord shall be in the midst thereof. When we get over chapter 48, how he divides up the land, in the middle of the land, he's got this holy oblation, this part, this is holy ground. And in the midst of that, in the center of that, is where the throne of God's going to be. So we're talking about the command center of everything. So when you're looking at this stuff back in chapter 43, and you begin to think about the temple, and you begin to think about the sacrifices and all the things, remember what you're dealing with. Jesus said it in Matthew 5, he said, don't swear by the heavens. Look at the verse, Matthew 5, verse 35. You better read it. If I quote it to you, you won't remember what I said. Matthew 5, verse 34. But I say unto you, swear not at all, neither by heaven, for it is God's throne, nor by the earth, for it is his footstool, neither by Jerusalem, for it is the city of the great king. When he said that, God's throne was in heaven. But now, when Christ comes back, he sets up his throne. Where his presence is where his government comes from. Now he's put that throne in the city of Jerusalem. It's now the city of the great king. So when you're thinking about this, and the reason I mention that is because if the whole universe is going to be centered in Jerusalem, which is the center of the earth is now going to be the command center of the whole universe. Jerusalem is going to be the center of that. The temple where redeemed Israel, where the saints of God, the resurrected saints, the adults operating in the new covenant, right? His role all written in the heart. They understand these things. Now, from there, they're going to use these sacrifices to teach the nations the importance of being separated unto Jehovah alone, not to be associated with the other gods that they've been given allegiance to. Come back with me to Deuteronomy chapter 32. All of this stuff revolves around the satanic policy of evil and God's intention and procedure for defeating and subjugating the chaos in his creation produced by that. Deuteronomy 32, this is the song of Moses. Verse number 7, remember the days of old, consider the years of many generations. Ask thy father, and he will show thee, thy elders, and they will tell thee. When the Most High, now you remember what that title, the Most High, talks about. The Most High God, the possessor of heaven and earth. That's what he's identified with in Genesis chapter 14 with Melchizedek and Abraham. But that's the title that Satan, Lucifer, said, I want to be like the Most High. Satan's desire is to take that position away from the Creator. I want to be the one who possesses all authority. Everybody answers to me. I'll take that governmental position away from him. When the Most High divided to the nations their inheritance, when he separated the sons of Adam, he set the bounds of the people according to the number of the children of Israel. For the Lord's portion is his people. Jacob is the lot of his inheritance. Notice the Lord divides to the nations their inheritance. That took place at the Tower of Babel. The nations didn't want to have God. We don't retain God in our knowledge. We don't do what God says. And so it came to the point where he gave them over. He gave them over to that reprobate mind. And when he did, he divided to the nations their inheritance. He literally turned them over to the gods of this world. I had a question that came this past week. It's a great question. I never actually thought about teaching about it, but I'm going to. In Deuteronomy, if you go back to chapter number 10, verse 17, Deuteronomy 10:17, for the Lord your God, that's Jehovah your God, Jehovah your Elohim, is God of gods and Lord of lords, a great God, a mighty and terrible, which rewardeth not persons, nor taketh reward. I've said to you, you've heard me say this 100 times, the God of the Bible is the big G of the little G's. So the question is, why would he call those little G's God? He takes his name, big G, and gives them the name, but just not with the big G. You're my servants. You're my, Genesis chapter 3, Satan says to Eve, he says, in the day you eat the thing, you're going to be like the gods out there. She could see the gods, the angels. Well, why would the Lord give the name gods to the angelic creation? Well, what's the name God, big G? He's the Most High. The word God is the term, it's like that term sovereign. The term sovereign is a term of government. If you look up in the dictionary, sovereign, it's a governmental term. We are a sovereign nation. I was listening to someone the other day, and they're talking about the president. And the fact that when he had this debate recently, he said that no soldiers under his watch had died. Well, you know, if the moderators had been on the toes right then, they'd have said, well, that's not true. You know, when they left Afghanistan his first year, they lost 30-something guys. And since then, there have been others. So, but nobody brings it up, but during the last 3.5 years, 7 U.S. embassies have closed, have been forced to close. An embassy is a piece of sovereign, you're a nation, you're a sovereign nation, and you have an embassy, and that ground of that embassy belongs to, that ground of that embassy is a part of the United States of America. It's in a different land, but the sovereignty, the governmental authority of our nation, our government, touches that. So the term sovereign is, the idea is, it's talking about government. That's why when they apply it to theology, it's God controlling all the stuff going on. Well, the word God is that word. The term God means the sovereign government, the head of the government. So he uses the little g because he administers his government through the angelic creation. You following that? So when he says gods, these are people who are out, these are creatures, angelic in the angelic world, who are out doing the government that he established. They're out carrying out his assignments. Come back with me to Colossians chapter 1. To really appreciate why there's a body of Christ and what we're doing today, why there's a mystery program, you have to kind of get a hold of what's bigger than just, you know, politics on a local level. Colossians 1 verse 16, for by him, that's the Lord Jesus, were all things created that are in heaven and in earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or powers. All those positions of rank and authority in the government of the earth and the heavens. You see, when God created, when he made creation, he didn't just throw it out there and leave it with nothing. He created it with a governmental structure to operate it. It was created by him and for him. They were created, there's a structure of government that he established to accomplish his will in his creation. Now, a throne, a principality, power, those are positions, but they got to have somebody in them. So the angelic creation would fill up the heavenly government. He created man into the earthly government and established man and gave man the authority, told Adam, go out and have dominion. Go out and exercise the responsibilities and so forth. So when you think about the throne of God, you have to remember that there's this universe that's being ruled. It didn't just, you know, I'm sitting on the throne, who do I run? There's this whole structure. And come back with me in connection with the temple to Isaiah chapter 40. Isaiah chapter 40. And I got 6 minutes to talk to you about this, and this is like a two-hour study, but most of you have been through this before enough, you should grasp this. Isaiah 40, verse number 21. Talking about creation. Now, by the way, when Moses wrote Genesis, I mean, Moses lived in the book, time of the book of Exodus. He wrote Genesis about what took place back there. So Israel in the time of Exodus already knew a lot of that information. Verse 21, have you not known? Have you not heard? The answer to this is, oh, yes. Has it not been told you from the beginning? Have you not understood from the foundations of the earth? It is he that sitteth upon the circle of the earth. The inhabitants thereof are as grasshoppers in his sight, that stretcheth out the heavens as a curtain and spreadeth them out, now watch, as a tent to dwell in. So the idea is that when God, in Genesis chapter 1, in the beginning God created the heaven and the earth, and the earth was without form and void and darkness upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters, and the Spirit of God said and began to speak, let there be light. He creates a universe, spreads it out, and does it like a temple. The earth has three heavens. The universe has three heavens. You remember Paul said, I caught up in the third heaven? You have the earth where the birds fly. You have the starry heavens, and you have the third heaven. How many parts are there in the temple? The tabernacle, there was a court, holy place, holy, most holy. In the tabernacle, in the temple of Solomon, same kind of thing. Three. In the temple in Ezekiel 40 to 48, the same kind of structure. So what you're having is the temple is really a model of the universe. And when you think of it that way, you begin to realize you can look at what goes on in the temple and you can get something of an idea about what God's plan and purpose and operating in his universe is like. So what we're going to be looking at as we go through these chapters here, and looking at the sacrifices and looking at these things, is really you're going to be looking at some things in connection with what God's operating. The reason he puts the command center on the earth is because it's the command center not just of the earth, but of the whole cosmos. And that's what that mount of the congregation on the sides of the north that Satan wanted to take over, that's where that meeting of the divine thinkers are. That's that place where the Godhead gets together, the council, the host of heaven, and makes the decisions. That's where they go out. That's why Jesus said, you're going to see the angels ascending and descending off the Son of Man in the kingdom. You think about that. If the angels lived out there, wouldn't you be seeing them descend and ascend? Well, yeah. Well, then why would they be ascending and descending? Because this is where they get their orders from. They go out and do the work, and they come back. Why? Because that's where the throne is. So in that temple, it's more than just a bunch of religious stuff going on. There's something important going on. And by the way, and we'll see this as we go through. I don't have time to go through it. But if you look at Ezekiel chapter 40, verse 1, I pointed out to you when we started, in the 25th year of our captivity, in the beginning of the year, in the 10th day of the month, the 14th year after that city was smitten, the 25th year, you read commentaries on Ezekiel and they try to figure out why. There's a lot of dates in Ezekiel. What's the 25th year of our captivity got to do with it? In the beginning of the year, in the 10th day of the month, if you read through from here to 48, the number that is most prominent is the number 50. And the reason for that is that's the year of Jubilee. I'm trying to see if you know what the year of Jubilee is. You go 49 years, seven Sabbath years. Sabbath of 7 years. By the way, Genesis chapter 1, what did he do? He 6 days, the seventh day, he did what? He rested, the Sabbath. Psalm 132 talks about the millennial kingdom, the kingdom being the time of his rest. The 7 days of creation, then the rest. What does he do? He tells Israel, you got seven Sabbaths, 49 years, and the next year is the year of Jubilee. Everything goes free. Everything is set free. And you have the year of Jubilee, the year of rejoicing. Isaiah 61, when it talks about the kingdom. Isaiah 61, verse 1. This is the passage Christ quotes in Luke 4. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me. That's the Lord Jesus. Because the Lord hath anointed me to preach the gospel, preach good tidings, unto the meek. And he hath sent me to bind up the brokenhearted and to proclaim liberty to the captives. Go back to Leviticus 25 and see where he says they go out and proclaim liberty throughout the land. You know what the Liberty Bell is in Philadelphia? You remember your American history? And it's got written on it, proclaim liberty throughout the land. Did you know that's a quote out of Leviticus chapter 25? The year of Jubilee. Half of that. Why would it be 25? Well, they're in captivity. But then it says in chapter 40, verse 1, on the 10th day of the month. You know what day of the month the year of Jubilee began? Yeah, it's interesting. Do you remember the Passover? Look over at chapter 45. They keep two feasts. Chapter 45. Verse number 21. In the first month, in the 14th day of the month, you shall have the Passover, a feast of seven days. Then you have the Feast of Tabernacles down in verse 25. They don't do the other feast, but they do the first one and the last one. When he says, the 14th day of the month. You remember in Exodus chapter 2 what they did on the 10th day of the month? They went out and took the lamb that they're going to figure, and they put him aside, and they watched him for 3 days to make sure he was perfect. So the Passover lamb is slain on the 14th, but you pick him out on the 10th. This is the guy that's going to get us to the deliverance. So when you're doing that, in Ezekiel, the number 40, I'm sorry, the number 50, 25, there in chapter 1, is used 8 times in these last chapters, but the number 10 times, 100 is used 18 times, 250 is used 4 times, 500 is used 8 times, 1,000 is used 24 times, 5,000 is used 2 times, 10,000 is used 7 times, and 25,000 is used 14. All those are numbers, multiples of 5. And you say, why would he build stuff? Now, who built it? Christ built it. But he built it with measurements that match the doctrines of proclaimed liberty throughout the land. Now, that's intelligent, prophetic foreshadowing. So the literal construction is teaching the doctrine of the liberty that's provided in the Messiah. And that doctrine is what they're going to be communicating to the Gentiles. And they'll be able to point, see these things, how he's prepared it. Now, you and I do that on occasion. We look at things and we see the wonder of it. Look with me. I'm going to give you an illustration. Not my notes. I'm just going to do this. Look at Deuteronomy chapter 17, chapter 16. Deuteronomy 16. Now, this is a similar weird thing that you can believe or you cannot believe it. It's up to you. It's just one of these things. Deuteronomy 16, 11. Now, when I say 16:11, what do you think of? King James Bible. That's the year it was published. In 16:11, count for me from verse 11. What is the seventh word in that verse? Lord. If you take a concordance, you better use a computer, and you look up the word Lord, that's the 1600th and 11th occurrence of the word Lord. Now that's weird. You see down toward the end of the verse where it says, which the Lord God, thy God, hath chosen, that's the 49th word in the verse. What's 49? 7 times 7? That's the 1612th occurrence of the word Lord in your Bible. Did you know that in 1611, the King James Bible was published for the first time? And it was published in a big folio strapped pulpits. In 1612, they published the individual version. You know, you've seen that one I've got in the office that I bring out at the men's meeting. That's a personal study Bible. And you say, well, that's interesting. Both publication dates in the same verse, Mark 16:11. And the 1611th occurrence, 16. And you say, what's that? Beats the fire out of me. But you know, when you see that, you say, And you can do numbers like that over and over and over and over again. And you say, wow, those things kind of confirm something that the doctrines that I've been learning tell me. That's the kind of thing that those numbers and the sacrifices will be designed to teach the nation Israel, some doctrine that they're being taught. And it's illustrated by that. Okay? All right, now that I've made myself a nutcase, I'll quit. I don't know, it'll be next week, it'll be the week after the Bible conference, we'll go through. I want to go through first part of Leviticus with you, and let you see. The sacrifices in Leviticus were not related to taking away personal sin. That's what those verses in Hebrews said. They don't take away sin. Then what were they for? They were to keep holy the holy place. Keep it sanctified. Keep people from polluting it. Because if you pollute where God lives, he's got to leave. And that's what had happened with Israel. When he comes back, he says, nobody's going to pollute. Redeemed Israel won't do it. But the Gentiles then have to learn not to do it. And it takes 1,000 years, and the ones who learn go out into the new kingdom. Okay? All right. I just summarized in 30 seconds what's going to take 2 hours to teach. It's always good to have a purpose statement. All right? Okay, praise the Lord. Father, thank you for your love and your grace. And thank you for the time that you give us to study your word and to try to appreciate the things that are here and that honor your wisdom. And we just pray we might appreciate the privilege that you give us for it. In Christ's name, amen. All right.